It's really two books, one about Savannah and the kookiness of it and the beauty of it and the wonderfulness of it, and then, boom, a shooting.
In Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil came out back in 1994.
Right away, it became a bestseller, and it didn't stop.
It is a fascinating story.
The book came out, and the city was never the same again.
I am astonished every time I think about it.
WJCL 22 presents Chronicle, Midnight Miracle.
It might be hard to believe, but the book Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil, it's been around for over 30 years now.
And while many of the real-life people depicted in the novel have since passed away, there's still one person who's still around and who we were lucky enough to speak with.
With that said, let's catch up with the man who started it all, the author, John Barrett.
Well, I am astonished every time I think about it. No, I didn't expect it. When Random House said, I think this is going to be a winner, I thought, okay. You say that to all your authors.
But John Barrett isn't like other authors. This 84-year-old Harvard grad, born and raised in upstate New York, responsible for helping put Savannah on the map. His 1994 bestseller, Midnight in a Garden of Good and Evil, was simply put a phenomenon, spending a record-breaking 216 weeks on the New York Times bestseller list, and is still responsible for attracting hundreds of thousands of tourists to Savannah each and every year.
I thought, and I predicted this, I said, it will make Savannah look wonderful, and people will visit it more than they have in the past. But beyond being, you know, a sort of cult favorite, I don't think it will make the bestseller list, because people constantly ask me that.
Just days after the book celebrated its 30th anniversary, Barrett returning to the Garden of Good and Evil, a headliner at the Savannah Book Festival, where he spoke to a capacity crowd at the Savannah Theater and visited with fans still mad for Midnight.
Do you ever get tired of talking about the book?
I don't. Because I just, something clicks, and I relive it all over again. It was a very happy, exciting period of my life.
Midnight in a Garden of Good and Evil, considered faction, part fact, part fiction, a murder, colorful real-life characters, and plenty of Southern charm, all captured on pages in this book, Savannah's book, penned by a Yankee, celebrated by so many here in the Deep South.
I just love Savannah. Why not? I mean, it's a lovable place and a beautiful place. All you have to do is look around at you.
Jim Williams' contributions to the city of Savannah and the Lowcountry can still be felt to this day. Before the death of Danny Hansford and the subsequent murder trials that rocked the nation, Williams was a well-known antiques dealer with a passion for historic preservation. Born in Gordon, Georgia, Williams is described as having moved to Savannah without a dime in 1952 at the age of 21. 3 years later, he bought and restored his first three homes located on Congress Street. Williams then spent the next 35 years of his life amassing his fortune, running his antiques business, and restoring more than 50 homes across the city and the Lowcountry, the most famous of which are the Pink House and the Mercer Williams House, which he lived in for many years. Without a doubt, the city of Savannah would not be what it is today if not for Jim Williams' dedication to history and his deep love for the hostess city.
Every year, more than a million tourists visit famed Bonaventure Cemetery, featured in both the book and film versions of Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil. But what is it about this seemingly solemn place that draws so many lively people?
It's the enchanting beauty, because you see nothing like this anywhere else. And the fascinating history that goes along with being in Savannah.
Bonaventure Cemetery is well known for its rich history and beauty, as well as its hauntings. Among the many familiar faces to be found buried here is Danny Hansford, his name made famous in the book Midnight in a Garden of Good and Evil as a young man who was shot and killed inside the Mercer Williams House.
A lot of people come to visit Danny's grave, and when I come by his grave, people have left little gifts of coins, cigarettes, sometimes beer, and they will also leave cars, little model cars that are close to or sometimes the exact replica of the car that he had during his life.
However, you won't find Danny's grave on the grounds of Bonaventure. Instead, his final resting place is the cemetery's extension located right next door.
Both Danny and his mother are actually buried here at Greenwich, which is a part of Bonaventure Cemetery, technically. But I view them as two different cemeteries because they're not physically connected to each other.
Edenfield adds she's glad the book draws so many visitors to Danny's grave every year.
Danny is, in my opinion, kind of considered an afterthought. But in life, he was a real person, and he had dreams and hopes and tragedies just like the rest of us.
As for the book's impact on tourism?
Yeah, upside is there are more visitors to the cemetery. The downside is there are more visitors to the cemetery. We love showing off this amazing beauty and sharing the history with our visitors. But we also enjoy being able to help the loved ones who frequently come by the cemetery.
For anyone hoping to visit for the first time or wishing to return, they have just one request.
We just ask that if you come out, that you be respectful.
In 1994, the city of Savannah welcomed 5 million visitors. In 2022, that number was 17 million. I spoke with experts who explained how one book helped turn the hostess city into the thriving tourist destination it is today.
30 years later, we're still getting visitors.
When many people think about the city of Savannah, this iconic novel, published in 1994, comes to mind.
The book and then in 97, the movie, right? I think that was sort of the big spark of tourism and the hospitality industry in Savannah.
Tourism experts say Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil helped put Savannah on the map.
To this day, you can stand on street corners and see visitors still holding the book and looking for certain icons.
A lot of people had heard of Savannah before, but through the book and through the movie, people fell in love, not just with the architecture, which we've always known was extraordinary, but the characters in Savannah.
Michael Owen, CEO of the Tourism Leadership Council, says he feels the book also made the hostess city a better place to live and work.
This was a catalyst to a boon in our community that didn't just drive up revenues and create new businesses and create new jobs. It protected our institutions that many would say before then were in a really bad spot and close to closing.
Nowadays, Savannah's architecture, food scene, and history draw in many of the visitors who come here. But if it weren't for this book, things could be different.
Without those key linchpins in the beginning, we certainly wouldn't be where we are today.
Lady Chablis is arguably one of the most iconic characters from Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil. But her legacy extends well beyond the pages of the best-selling novel and the screen in which she portrayed herself. Most people who knew Lady Chablis, a.k.a. the Grand Empress, were immediately taken with her. That includes the owners of Club One, a Savannah nightclub that hosts drag shows.
She could say and do things that people were thinking, and people just loved it.
Chablis was a very much independent spirit with her own mind.
Lady Chablis was the first person to perform at Club One when it opened in 1988.
She was always a big star. She always had this presence, and people would come far and wide to see her.
After the book's debut, Chablis became an instant national sensation.
She called and said, "Hey y'all, something big's about to happen." She said, "Well, there's this book coming out by John Barrett." And about 2 weeks after that, Good Morning America called.
Good Morning America. It's changed my life tremendously. Also, John Barron made me a promise when he wrote that book. He says, "You're going to be famous," and he kept his promise.
Lady Chablis was also her own advocate when it came time to cast the film.
She called Clint Eastwood herself and said, "I'm going to be Lady Chablis in the movie because I'm the only Lady Chablis."
Despite her celebrity, Lady Chablis always gave back. She donated her time and money to help kids and people with diabetes or AIDS, as well as queer organizations.
She was fundamental in raising money for First City Network, and that was the oldest LGBT organization in the state.
Then in 2016, at the age of 59, Lady Chablis fell ill with pneumonia. And after a month-long stay at Candler Hospital in Savannah, she passed away.
Well, I was actually spent the night with her in the hospital the night before she died.
Lady Chablis stayed true to herself to the very end, and if her loved ones could speak to her one last time, they would say,
"Well, I just miss her."
The famous Bird Girl statue, featured on the cover of Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil, was originally housed at Savannah's historic Bonaventure Cemetery before being relocated to a nearby museum in 2014. Was it A, the Savannah History Museum, B, the Telfair Museum, or C, the Mercer Williams House? You're watching Chronicle, Midnight Miracle. The answer when we return. You're watching Chronicle, Midnight Miracle. The famous Bird Girl statue, featured on the cover of Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil, was relocated to B, the Telfair Museum, back in 2014. And to this day, it remains there on display, gathering tens of thousands of visitors every year.
Some of the iconic locations mentioned in the book Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil still remain at their original locations to this day, and many of Savannah's tourists come visit in the hopes of tracking them all down. So in a city that already offers horse-drawn carriage tours, hearse tours, and so much more, book tours are now also offered.
It brought so many people here just because of the book.
Angela Sergi has been giving Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil tours.
So I'm going to pass that back to you.
For many years now.
You know, when I started out, there was no one doing a book tour. Previously, there had been two other ladies who were doing it. So I just decided to do it.
Every week, she takes visitors on a ride around the hostess city.
Do welcome you to Savannah.
Showing them the sights mentioned in the book and movie.
And here's Clary's Cafe. This is where Luther came every morning. Luther Driggers, he was a chemist.
She says during her tour, she likes to point out the differences between the film.
The cemetery scenes for the movie were filmed here.
And the book.
Some of the names were not the real names like the author. And the fact that there was only one trial in the movie when there were actually four.
She says it's her hope that by taking people around and showing them the sites mentioned in this story.
Here you have the Mercer House.
People will also learn about Savannah's history and the work Jim Williams did to make the city what it is today.
We cover areas that where Jim started out restoring houses and show where the people lived, where they filmed them living, and where they actually did live.
And she looks forward to giving even more book tours in the years to come.
It is a fascinating story.
Mandy Nichols is another familiar character featured in the book Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil. But in real life, the personality that inspired her lived a very different life. Her name, Nancy Hillis, AKA the Vamp of Savannah.
Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil shined a spotlight on Savannah and introduced the world to a cast of real-life, colorful characters.
She always wore a pink feather boa, always believed that the bigger the hair, the closer to Jesus.
Statesboro's Wes Bonner, the son of one of the eccentric Savannah personalities, featured in John Barrett's bestseller and later in the movie adaptation. His late mom, Nancy Hillis, inspired the character, Southern sweetheart, Mandy Nichols.
Welcome to Savannah.
I think for the most part, it was a pretty accurate, especially the depiction of all the unique characters of Savannah. I thought they did a great job in the book and the movie of showing that.
In the book, Barrett describes Nancy Hillis as a statuesque beauty with not a single angular contour on her soft and lovely body. Her blue eyes were set off by a bright framework of lavishly applied cosmetics. But Wes Bonner says his mother was that and a whole lot more.
One of the most amazing things about my mom was her generosity. She would do anything, give you the shirt off her back.
Nancy Hillis was an accomplished singer and entrepreneur. The single mother wasn't originally from Savannah, but this strong, independent, larger-than-life woman was able to thrive beneath the moss-covered oaks. She was a fighter till her passing back in 2016 after a lengthy battle with Lou Gehrig's disease.
I got a letter from Mayo Clinic in Jacksonville that said, prepare, you know, for your mom to no longer be here in about 6 months, and she lived almost 5 years. I think what drove her to live was writing her book.
The character Minerva from Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil was inspired by a real-life woman named Valerie Bowles, who was also a root doctor from South Carolina. Which Beaufort County town did Bowles live in up until the day of her death? Was it A. Beaufort, B. Burton, or C. Bluffton? You're watching Chronicle, Midnight Miracle. The answer after the break. You're watching Chronicle, Midnight Miracle. Valerie Bowles, the real-life inspiration behind the character of Minerva from Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil, was a root doctor who lived in A. the town of Beaufort for many decades until her death in 2009. She was 76 years old.
Savannah native Sonny Seiler is remembered in a lot of different ways. For folks at the University of Georgia, of course, he was the owner of the live Bulldog mascots. In the professional world, he was actually Jim Williams' defense attorney. And in the movie Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil, he actually played the judge. But above all else, he's remembered as a loving father.
My father was a very busy man, but he always made time for the four of us and my mother, and we were quite proud of him.
Swan Seiler, daughter of the late Sonny Seiler, says she remembers the night Danny Hansford was fatally shot by Jim Williams.
It caused quite a stir in that those type things didn't happen often.
She also recalls the four trials that followed, the first and second of which ended in guilty verdicts.
After the first trial, I believe Jim felt that maybe a local attorney would be more popular with the locals and especially a local jury, and so that's when he hired my father.
After the third trial resulted in a hung jury, the decision was made to move proceedings from Savannah to Augusta. And nearly a decade after Hansford's death, Williams was acquitted of charges. Jim Williams, the first person in Georgia history to be tried four times for the same crime, and it sparked national notoriety. In particular, it caught the eye of a writer from New York.
I remember Daddy introducing me to a gentleman, and he said, "Swan, meet John. He's writing a book on the trials."
Little did they know what the book would become.
How did you feel your ox came out?
Well, I think John flattered me, to tell you the truth.
And how it would change their lives forever.
When news that the movie was going to be filmed in Savannah, people were very excited.
Seiler, who was heavily featured throughout the novel, never imagined he would also be cast in a film version directed by Clint Eastwood.
As it turned out, Daddy would take the role of the judge. Jack Thompson, an Australian actor, would play my father.
In August of 2023, after a very long and robust life, Sonny Seiler passed away at the age of 90. But his memory lives on through his family, friends, and fans.
We were extremely touched by the outpouring of support that we received.
Savannah native Sonny Seiler was a devoted University of Georgia football fan, his family having spent the last 70 years raising and caring for the team's official Bulldog mascots. But which one is the most decorated in UGA history? Is it A. Uga 8, nicknamed Big Bad Bruce, B. Uga 9, aka Russ, or C. Uga 10, also known as Q? You're watching Chronicle, Midnight Miracle. The answer coming up next. You're watching Chronicle, Midnight Miracle. Savannah native Sonny Seiler was a devoted University of Georgia football fan, his family having spent the last 70 years raising and caring for the team's official Bulldog mascots, the most decorated in history being C. Uga 10, also known as Q. Q passed away in January of 2024, with an impressive football record of 91-18, two national championships, and two SEC titles.
And we can't discuss the success of the book Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil without also acknowledging its movie adaptation by the same name.
Directed by Clint Eastwood, the star-studded film debuted November 21st, 1997. Now, the night before, there was a special red carpet event right here in Savannah down at the Johnny Mercer Theater.